For you to really appreciate what's to follow, it's probably appropriate to first provide you with sort of the party line on systems and systems thinking so that you'll have a better appreciation for why it is that so many people are turned off by systems thinking. And then we'll sort of save you from all of that after we've given you a sense of why it is that people are turned off by it. And then you can appreciate how it's really not so difficult. So we begin with the question, you know, what is a system? If we begin with some entity, and we'll just call it A, could be almost anything, and we say that there is some relationship between A and some other entity, B, and because of the influence that A has on B, B reciprocates with some feedback to have some influence on A. So that there's a mutual interaction that's going on here. And that's sort of the essence of it, in that depending upon whether you're A or B, what you consider to be feedback is what happens after your influence on something else. Feedback is what comes back afterwards. But as I said, the secret is, or the essence of it is, existence, this set of relationships maintains its existence through the mutual interaction of these entities. And the way that things just continue on the way that they're going, it's because of the mutual interaction. And we'll provide some examples of systems in just a few short minutes. Though it's appropriate to realize that this set of interactions has a boundary or a context to it, so that there are things that outside that it influences or that influences it, though are not themselves actually addressable. They're not considered part of the system itself. And that also will become apparent when I show you some examples. So a system exhibits characteristics not produced by any subset of its parts, and it's called emergence. Is it confusing already? I would expect so. So that what we do is we look at a situation, and there are some set of interactions which are part of that which create that situation as it is. And there are entities in our relations between them, and it's that set of interactions, as we talked about before, that are responsible for the situation being the way that it is. And there is an environment, which is that stuff that's outside of the situation proper, and we delineate the environment so we know which things are which things are really part of the situation, part of the system that we call it, and which things are part of the environment. And oftentimes we also use boundaries to identify which ones of the stakeholders, which individuals or teams or groups are responsible for which of the entities that are involved in being the situation. See, it's even more confusing already, isn't it? Though, in terms of examples, one can consider a car to be a system, in that it has a purpose. Its intent is to take you from point A to point B. Some people have very different thoughts about the purpose of the car. Some people look at them as status symbols. Though, essentially, it's a vehicle that will take you from point A to point B. And there are components of this system which are essential, without which it cannot achieve its purpose. And then there are those pieces which are just sort of also, you can take the doors off of the car and it will still take you from point A to point B, though probably not nearly as safely. If you take the wheels off of the car, it won't take you anyplace. So the interaction of all of those parts on an ongoing basis enables it to fulfill its purpose of taking you from point A to point B. A clock is a set of interacting pieces that keep track of time, and all of the individual parts interact appropriately for it to keep time accurately. And it's that set of interactions that allows it to continue to function as a clock. I'll skip this one and this one. Now, water is, at room temperature, is two gases, hydrogen and oxygen, combined in a molecular form, which when lots of them are in the presence of other things, provides a property which we call wetness. Things dissolve in it. So it's a system. A bank, if you think about a bank as a place where you save money in a savings account, the principal increases over time based upon the interest that banks pay, based upon the money that you put in the account. And over time, the account actually grows. And it's that set of interactions which form the basis of a savings account, even though the interest rates are abysmal these days. And a pile of bricks is typically not considered a system, because if you take a brick away, it's still just a pile of bricks. Now, if you were to take that pile of bricks and actually stack them in an orderly form and use them to hold up the corner of a porch, then it would no longer be just a pile of bricks. It would be a post. And if you took one away and the post fell down, then it's more than just a pile of bricks. So that a system is a set of interactions that serves a purpose and exhibits characteristics that you can't find in any of the pieces themselves. In other words, if you take the clock apart, you can't find any of the pieces that keep time, but collectively they keep time. So that's sort of an initial thought about the example of what is a system, and you probably get a sense of why it is that people find systems confusing, because of the traditional conceptual definitions that have been put together to define it. And we'll show you how to get beyond this shortly. So I'll see you in the next video. Bye.